Oh boy. Andy, Ink and Echo, episode 13, where we ride Levi the Poet's coattails to fame and glory, baby.
Yeah. I was thinking, you know how in a like a boat or a hotel, there's no floor 13? Should we have done that on the podcast? Should we have not done a 13th episode?
Too late now. Now we're in spooky territory.
And leading up to Halloween, I don't know if this is a great idea.
Right. What do you mean a boat? What sort of boat has 13 floors?
What do you mean?
A cruise liner?
Yes. There's no 13th. Don't talk to me like that.
No, but really, I've never been on a cruise.
Oh.
I don't make a ton of money off Spotify, Andy.
Oh my God.
So I'm not used to your status of lifestyle.
I have not paid for my own cruise yet.
I know. Guys, hey, everybody. Levi Macallister is joining us on the show, and he brought along all his cats as well. All of his 10 or 9 cats from home. The only thing he left home was his wife.
Well, she didn't want to come. So.
No, she wouldn't. She wouldn't like this, would she?
She's very happy that I'm having a good time.
I think that's how all of our wives feel about this podcast.
I told her, I was like, hey, I get to be on the podcast this weekend. She was like, cool. I will never listen to that.
Perfect. Wait, Levi, before Josh got on the call, you were about to say that you thought something was so funny, and I want to know what it was.
That I thought was so funny?
Yeah, you're like, that thing was so funny. And then Josh started calling us. And I said, wait, you have to tell Josh.
I have no idea.
What?
Can you bring it
prompt
home
him?
A little more?
No, that's
literally... Do you know what it was?
No, you literally just said, that was so funny when... And that was
well,
it.
I don't know what it was.
It wasn't something on this podcast that you heard that was so funny?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. You're the, I mean, I guess it shouldn't have been funny because it's a real thing. But the sponsor for the last podcast.
You're dissing our sponsor?
No, I'm not. I'm tripping balls.
Do you need one?
I'm just glad.
Did you take advantage of the
like
offer?
Exist
yeah.
In the world.
Yeah, me too.
That's what I was saying. That's what I was talking. I want you to know that I'm a regular listener to your podcast.
Great.
Yeah.
Oh, good.
Great.
Good. I mean,
and I buy
really
everything.
Oh,
I
good.
Buy everything that
every you support all
every,
our sponsors.
All of your sponsors. Yeah.
Okay. Great.
I love that very real product. Listen, guys, I just finished 3 entire days of shooting a movie, a motion picture film for theaters, and I'd like to tell you a little about it.
Please, regale us with stories of film history, soon to be history.
Yeah, I want to know if the people... Got the people that you said are so bad at communicating that they can't possibly have lives or bank accounts. I'd like to know how they did.
The people you destroyed last week.
Thankfully, none of them listen to this show. So, honestly, that was a part of the learning experience, which is that, oh boy, there's a lot to tell. But specifically in regards to that, it is like, this is my project, and so I was excited about it for months and weeks prior, whereas everybody else, it was just a thing they were doing in the midst of many other things, and so their responsiveness was not great leading up to it, but on the days of, they were all about it, and very, very present, and they worked hard, and made the filming process actually super smooth. So that was cool. And it was just my own insanity and lack of experience that made me get so frustrated with people. So,
I mean, I guess the big question is your movie going to be good?
Yeah. Were you happy on Monday?
Yeah.
On Tuesday, Levi.
Oh,
on Monday, I was still shooting. Thanks for knowing, Levi.
You said you listened to the podcast.
I got my days wrong.
Yes. Yes. What? Levi's nice enough to come on our show and we just like completely insult him and tear him down.
We've insulted him when he wasn't even on the show.
That's true.
That's true.
But on Tuesday, yes. You were happy.
Yes, I was.
Good.
Yeah, it was a whirlwind, but I do think it will be a good movie, actually, but just so much more went into it than I...
Are you surprised that it's going to be good?
Well, so, no, listen, I mean, I believed that the story was good, but I realized even through making this that making a good story into a good movie is really challenging. Mm-hmm. And I know that's a little obscure, but for anyone who's even been on a movie set or close to one, kind of knows what I mean, that the translation is challenging for Wait, sure. But I, so go ahead.
I don't, I just say, I want to hear about, I don't think you've said here that the one of your main actors dropped out and you ended up being one of the main actors in it.
Well, oh, wow. That leads me to my next point.
Okay,
fact.
Continue.
So, so the story was we had hired an actor, as in he was the lead actor. He was going to get paid a good chunk of our budget.
He had a picture with you and McGregor or something, right? Or who was it?
Well, on his IMDb page, he was like hugging Matt Damon and he was sitting next to John Carpenter and he has a bunch of credits with very substantial movies. And
Jason
Bourne. Yeah, he was with Bourne. Yeah. So
go ahead.
2 weeks before filming, while I was on vacation in Seattle, trying to not think about the movie at all, I got an email that said, "Hey Josh, I'm really sorry. I'm working on this movie in Colorado Springs. It's been a disaster. Our filming got delayed. I cannot make your dates."
Was it in all caps?
No. Okay. No, he's a better person than that. Okay. But yeah, he basically said, and this guy's in his early 40s and he's been working in movies since his 20s. So he's got a lot more experience in this. And anyway, he was just like, You know, I can be in it if you can push it to early November. And we already had so many other pieces in place.
Right. And after November 8th, who knows what's happening in this country. So you got to film your movie now.
Indeed. That's what I've heard.
So
glad we're together on that, Levi.
So yes, I, knew that we were probably not going to find another actor in 2 weeks' time.
So you just bucked up and said, "You know what, guys? Hero Josh is here to save my own movie." That's what you said to yourself in the mirror?
Pulled an old M. Night Shyamalan.
You kind of pulled a huge Stephen King, even. He's in all of his movies.
Yeah, the guy? Wait a minute.
Oh, it's Stephen King. That's who you're thinking of.
No, yeah. What's the guy is in all of the superhero movies? He puts himself in all
Batman.
Of them.
Batman.
Stan Lee.
Bruce Wayne.
Stan Lee. Stan Lee.
Okay.
Okay, but let me just tell you guys this. I did this for my own curiosity. I did a word count on my own characters. This was post-filming, and I sort of even did this for the sake of saying it on this show. But so there's four characters in my entire movie. And so here is in ascending order the amount of lines needed to be spoken in the film according to the script that I wrote. So there's Neil, the bartender, that was played by my good buddy James Lapine, who has been on this show. Mm-hmm. So in this course of the movie, he had 15 lines, 15 words to say.
Okay.
Next we have Doug. He's a Harley motorcyclist. That's his character's name, Doug. He had 52 words to say.
Third, wait, words, not lines? 52 words. Okay.
Right. Yeah, out of all his lines.
Okay.
Total 52 words. Jermaine, he's my supporting actor who I spent the most time with. So he had 424 words to say. you know, it's getting a little more up there.
Okay, yours, 20, let me guess. Let me guess, yours was 719.
Mine was 1,834 words to say.
Wow.
In 3 days' time. So even on average, on a daily average, I had more lines to memorize than the rest of my characters had in the entire span of the film. And I'm not tooting my own horn, but it was just like that added such a different element, having to memorize a ton of words and do 5 to 7 minute takes.
Oh man.
Like single takes that lasted 5 to 7 minutes. That is pretty uncommon unless you're Birdman. So
dang,
it was just a lot.
How did it go?
Yeah.
How did you?
Well,
I mean, I'm just basing it off of the amount of anxiety that has gone on to other parts of this film. That seems very intense. I'm not mocking you.
No, I know. Oddly enough, so Friday night before the first day of filming, I was petrified. I could not go to sleep. I was almost literally quivering in the shower. You know, like, how am I going to do this? What the hell was I thinking? But then, honestly, it was like, as soon as I got to set at 6 a.m. the next day and saw how positive all my crew was. I mean, these were people I had never even met. These were just friends of Trevor, my DP, who had come onto the film voluntarily. Most of them were not getting paid. Everybody was so happy to be there. They were so excited about how pretty the location was. And it was like all of that anxiety dissolved. And
that's awesome.
I had there were challenges during the days of shooting, but I had an incredible experience. Yeah. People were so cool. And I think at this level, I've realized at this very small, you know, Colorado scene, low budget or no budget, people are pretty cool. There were definitely no attitudes, no
egos,
nothing like that. Yeah. Everybody was happy to be there, happy to be getting credit and experience. And
that's
it was just cool. They took really good care of me. Yeah. I had a ridiculously smooth, first short film experience.
Nice.
Yeah.
I love the idea of that.
It was beautiful.
Big of a collaborative project, I think, anyway. Yeah. I think I love that idea.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Have you've not done anything that big, Levi?
No. Correspondence was the biggest thing. But
even,
like, who was the guy, who was the brewmaster that was on?
Scott.
Yeah, Scott. So before that episode, you were talking about coming into your room and being like, I could just not do this.
Right.
And telling Josh, you can't just not do that with all of these people there, you know? But I don't know. It seems cool. Like, I think collaborating with other people, whenever that does get to happen, it always ends up being
to everyone's benefit.
Yeah, to everyone's benefit, and more fun too. Like, you were talking about the loneliness of coming up in your room and just being here by yourself. I think that writing is super lonely too.
Yeah.
You know? So
yeah.
It's cool to hear you getting to connect with that many people that were all enthusiastic about it as well.
Yeah,
for sure. Let me just touch on a few more quick things. I don't mean to monopolize the
talk. No, it's your story.
Cordial Kill. So one that is sort of interesting, Andy, I might have told you this, but so we ordered these, they're called theater cigarettes. One of our main characters is basically chain smoking through the whole story. And so these are the same things they used on Mad Men and many other productions. But so it's a cigarette that is.
Can I have one? Do you have some left over?
I do.
Nice.
It's it's just dried fruit and herbs. And so it looks like a standard cigarette. It smokes and burns like one, but it is much, there's no tobacco, no additives, and it's very clean, so to speak, for your lungs. But they taste like you are sucking on a campfire. I mean, they're very smooth, but the flavor is pretty bizarre.
You'd think they'd really want to make them flavorless to not throw you off. I don't know. Maybe then it would be some other problem. I mean,
are they harsh? Do you get a burn at all?
No, it's very smooth. But yeah, just the taste it leaves in your mouth is pretty odd. So that was kind of interesting.
Interesting.
And so this other thing, you guys are both, you're both cranked up tonight.
Well,
feeling good.
I'm just sitting here looking at him. He's just giggling.
Just looking at that little baby face.
There's a little bit of dirt on it right now.
So something else that we had to do that was, to me, daunting and exhausting was something called recording wild lines. So two of our days of shooting were outdoors, and we actually had flown in, Trevor flew in a professional sound guy from Los Angeles to work on this movie. And I mean, I don't mind saying this, his payment for the entire shoot was $600. So that's a fairly decent chunk of our budget, but also he knew his stuff.
Nice.
So because Trevor had talked about previously just how you can make a really pretty movie that sounds terrible if you don't have a good sound guy.
Right.
So anyway, after these days of shooting, after 10 hours of work, then the sound guy would pull us aside and we would basically walk off to a secluded area and have to go through all of our lines again in a sort of quiet environment so that we get the natural sounds of outside. But we had a little interference with cars going by or, you know, geese honking, dogs barking, planes going overhead. And it's just, I don't know. It was only daunting because there was this sense that, oh, the day's over. And then this guy comes up and is like, hey, we need to go get this again. And that actually ended up taking another 20 or 30 minutes because even during recording wild lines, we would get more interference. And he's like, can you give me that line again, please? So
I mean, would they have to sync it to the actual footage then? So your inflection had to match.
I mean, it's like as close as you can get it.
Right.
And it's really just so you have a safety, so you have an audio safety.
Sure.
So even if you have to cut away from the actor's mouth literally moving, but just so that you still have the audio portion of that dialogue, you know, it's... Anyway.
Yeah, that makes sense. That's crazy, though.
It was a lot.
Did you not know you were going to have to do that?
No, not at all. But our first location especially was pretty close to a major road. And so all day it was just like, you know, a motorcycle would go by in the middle of a take and we wouldn't stop acting. But, you know, that's why we get stuff like that. So anyway, just definitely a learning experience for me. And I'm very glad we had him on set.
Yeah. And is he going to be, is he just handing over the files and you have to edit it, or is he involved in post at all?
He is not. What's nice about, so he has equipment that is fancy enough that it aligns perfectly to Trevor's time code in his camera. Wow. So, he would be programming the name and number of the takes at the same time that Trevor was. So basically in editing, I know exactly what audio file lines up with the video. Yeah. He had this whole, it was a harness that went around him and kind of like an enormous fanny pack looking thing that was basically an entire mini mixing board right in front of him in his lap.
Dang. So, that's crazy.
And we had little lav microphones that pinned to our chest. And then he also did the boom mic overhead. So it was nuts. There was a lot just for audio.
How did you meet all these people, Josh?
Well,
have you already talked about this? Is this boring?
Yeah, we got to skip this. We've already talked about it. Sorry.
No, it's a quick answer.
I'm just kidding.
I mean, basically, so Trevor, my next door neighbor, who was also the director of photography on this movie, he has done a ton of work in film in Colorado, and just he knows all these people. So he recruited these folks either for favor or just because they wanted to help, or in some cases, like the sound guy, we were able to pay them what they're actually worth, you know, because they are actively working in the film industry. So yeah, it was pretty much all Trevor.
That's great.
Yeah.
Nice. Good neighbors you picked there.
Yeah, it's super convenient.
Yeah. You guys want to hear a gory child story?
Wow.
Why would I want to hear that?
Because it's about one of my children.
Okay.
Okay.
Sure.
Are you... Okay, keep
going. I'll just tell you if you want. Okay. So this is two nights ago, my wife, she dances at least two nights a week usually. So I give the kids food and put them to bed. So I had done that this night. I was up in my room about to watch a movie, and then I hear my three-year-old Blake start crying in his bed. So I go downstairs, and he's just like sort of not awake. He's like not really able to talk very well. And I'm just trying to like, what's wrong? Just tell me what's wrong. And he's just like super upset. And he kind of rolls over, and like a little bit of blood comes out of his nose. I'm like, oh, you have a bloody nose. Like, so I pulled him out of his crib, and then blood just starts gushing out of his nose and his mouth.
What?
Oh, yeah. My gosh.
And he like can't really talk. He's kind of like gurgling. So I just like, and I don't know if you know this, Josh, but I'm just super squeamish with like real blood. I just kind of shut down. So I took him to the bathroom, had him keep spitting, but the blood just kept coming out of his mouth. Oh. And I was just like, I tried to look at his tongue. Like, did he bite his tongue? I looked at it. I didn't see anything there. And so I had my father-in-law come over, and I got him in the car. We were going to urgent care, and I gave him a towel. So I just threw him in the front seat of my truck because my wife had the van. So he was just spitting blood all on this towel, and I kept telling him to spit. And then eventually, before we got to urgent care, it stopped, and he's just sitting there, and he's like, I'm fine now. And I was like, are you serious? So we pulled over, and I looked in his mouth. I didn't see any cuts or anything, but he was like not bleeding. He was fine. But I had like blood all over my arms, like my shirt, like his shirt was just soaked with blood. Oh. And I think what happened was he's been like a notorious nosebleeder, but he's since gotten sick. So I think he was just starting to get sick. It's super dry. And I think he just had a terrible bloody nose, but I was just so freaked out.
It was just draining down through.
Yeah. Cause he was sleeping on his back. So I think that's just what it was. But the fact that it was coming out of both his nose and his mouth, I was like, this is not normal.
That's scary. Terrifying. Did you take him to, did you continue to urgent care then?
No. I mean, I sat there and looked and like, you know,
nothing happened.
Yeah. And so he ended up having another bloody nose later in the night, but it wasn't nearly as bad. Wow. It's just, I haven't been that frightened since my kids were born.
Yeah, man. That's significant. Scary. Yeah.
I tried to call Megan's dance studio. No one would answer. She wasn't answering her phone. I couldn't. My mother-in-law didn't answer her phone at first. I was like, I don't know what to do. My armpits immediately got the stinkiest they've ever been. Just
wow. That was like noticeable, huh?
Yeah, oh, yeah. Immediately. Yes. The adrenaline just like, I was just like, oh, this is gross. Yeah.
Wow.
It was for real, man.
Wow.
Did
I
mean, was Megan freaked out when she got home and finally heard all of this?
Well, there were like two texts and three missed phone calls. I was like, hey, emergency call now. Like, didn't even use all the words because I was trying to, you know, which is freaky to see when you pull out your phone. So she,
right.
But by that point, by the time she was done, it was all fine. Like had him in the bath and he was just relaxing. And so she missed it all and it was fine. But,
oh boy.
It was intense, dude.
Yeah.
Yeah. That, I mean, that's my story. There's nothing funny about it, but I was real smelly and really scared.
That's crazy. I mean,
Levi, what if one of your cats was bleeding?
What if Gilbert was bleeding out of his anus and his eyes?
I mean, when you first started talking about it, I thought it was maybe not real and going to be like a horror, like, kind of a story. I mean, it's a horror story, but I thought you were going to say that there was blood coming out of his ears and eyes or something. Like, no, absolutely insane.
I turn on
like
a flashlight like, under my face.
Every orifice. All the lights.
It's funny to joke about my kids bleeding all over the place.
Yeah, that's so funny, Levi. Wow.
Oh my gosh. I'm glad that didn't end up being the case.
Oh my gosh.
If Gilbert started bleeding out of his nose and mouth, I would picture Pet Cemetery
or Cujo, right?
Throw him in traffic. I live on a corner property. There's plenty of traffic going by most of the time. And I feel like I could easily explain to my wife.
The first sight of blood, you'd be like, I just gotta immediately toss him in front of a semi. No hesitation.
Or it would just be this, like a jump cut to... A jump cut to Levi carrying a trash bag out to the trash and just sort of dumping it.
It's just kind of a dripping trash bag.
That's so sad. I honestly love my cat, but I don't know where it came around that we have nine. I have one cat.
Well, because the amount you talk about the one, you might as well have 10.
I don't talk about him that much.
Well, okay, we went on tour for a month and I got to hear you say the same damn joke every night about your cat.
Oh, that's a great joke, though. Do you want to hear it, Josh?
Yeah, please.
I would like to hear that.
On that tour, the night ended with me talking.
Well, it started with you singing Linkin Park with everybody. That's how the night always started.
Linkin Park? Oh, yeah, because I would sound check to the Linkin Park
and
song.
Then everyone would just sing along, and we'd sing the whole song every night.
Yeah, it was good.
Uh-huh.
Linkin Park's a staple, man.
Yeah,
they're an important band.
Yeah.
And at the end of the show, though, I would talk about the record or do Q&A or whatever. But then at the very end, I would say I have things for sale, just like anyone has anything for sale. I don't know, you know, how many of you feel like you would like to support this, but... It was basically something like
all the proceeds tonight are going to go...
All the proceeds... Yeah.
Are gonna go we'll toward
going
helping
towards
animals.
Helping animals, and so any of you who really care about animals, who feel like animals, maybe even specifically cats, kittens, should have a home, I'm going to be donating your payment to me to that, and specifically to my cat Gilbert, and making sure that he has a home forever, mm-hmm. and that. That I can continue to provide a roof over his head. So you can help us both at the same time, was the gist of it. Delivery is better.
The delivery was far better. And you honed it over many nights.
I did.
You really got it down to a science.
The thing is, you got to practice while you're on tour. And then by the end, you get good enough to stop and forget it on a podcast where you're supposed to be funny.
Was that like a just for that tour joke? Did you retire it?
Every now and then I'll still say it if it seems appropriate.
But better than what you just did.
Better, yeah. Yeah, I mean, I pitch it well. I mean, I don't have...
Because your adrenaline's still going.
My
from
adrenaline's
the...
going. I know that people think I'm just so fascinating, so I can continue to be so funny, you know?
Uh-huh. Everyone's just wrapped.
I have nothing to lose right now.
Meanwhile, Brandy's like,
then.
Ugh.
No,
I mean, she's... Yeah,
no,
she
thought that was pretty...
She liked that one because she loves the cat as much as she likes me. Yeah. But I mean, there are definitely times when she's in the back like, please stop talking. Please. Yeah. Please, Lord, I just want to go. Please.
All right, are we ready for the sponsor here?
I hope so.
That question's for Levi, man.
Oh.
Uh. Oh, now for a word from our sponsor.
Yeah, that was the music for the sponsor. Oh,
okay. Well, guys, you know how sometimes you're having a conversation with your significant other?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe she's maybe your wife, even.
Yeah. I've talked to her before.
Yeah. And sometimes it takes a while to get through kind of to one another, and maybe especially she might feel as though it takes a while for what she has to say to get through to your brain.
Right. My biggest problem is she's giving me all these cues and I just never pick up on any of them, and then I'm like, I don't know what you want.
Right.
I mean, is there something that's going to help me?
And it
here?
Can be a long and drawn out and complicated process
for the
you
worst.
To figure out what she wants.
Like, can we just
hours?
Let's just cut months, that out. Yeah, years.
Yeah.
Of regret.
Right. And so wouldn't you be glad if there was something that would help you just understand a little bit? Wouldn't she be glad?
Yeah,
I think she'd be glad. So our sponsor for today. Comes from Truth Serum.
Mm-hmm. It's crazy they just got that name, Truth Serum.
Yeah. Truth Serum is a feminine product. And what it is it's a powder. And if your wife it's for the ladies, of course. It's a feminine
product. It's a feminine product, yeah.
If a woman, if she were to purchase
if she's not getting
powder,
through.
Right, if she's not getting through, if there's frustrations in the relationship, and the, you know, in any part of the relationship, she can purchase Truth Serum. And basically what Truth Serum is it's a powder. And the powder, if blown on her significant other, on the man, if you will, it automatically bypasses the potential decades of pain and misunderstanding
that are getting in the way from understanding what the woman is saying.
Right.
Yeah. That's
and there
perfect.
Are there are but the best part about the Truth Serum. I mean, sometimes a man. I mean, you don't want to just walk up to a man and blow all of your.
Oh, he's
going to
be like, well, blah,
you don't
want to
blow feminine product all over you.
Right. Yeah.
Significant other.
You don't want to
so,
do
that. So,
there's got to be a great delivery mechanism.
There is. And this is where it gets good. Truth Serum is now shipping their product with three ring binder approved college ruled lined paper airplanes.
Mm-hmm. Oh, man.
That you can sprinkle the Truth Serum powder into. Some of them come with instructions shipped in kind of like a folder, like a, say a school book folder, normal. But some come, pre-planed, if you will.
Pre-planned.
Pre-planned, pre-planned.
PP and PP.
Correct. Pre-folded even into the shape of the perfect airplane.
I'll tell you what, if anyone was delivering me a feminine product, I'd like it. To be in a paper airplane.
Paper airplane.
Yeah.
So, there's a couple of different tier options, of course. You know, all of these online purchases, they have different tier options nowadays. But they've done a really good job at FedEx shipping a box full of popcorn, the little popcorn things.
Those peanuts.
Right, the popcorn peanuts.
Popcorn peanuts.
Protecting a professionally folded paper airplane, if you will, inside of the box. And what happens is it shows up to your door, preloaded, pre-folded. You pick it up, and as soon as it's unwrapped,
ready to deliver a feminine product.
Correct. So, as long as the woman is the one who gets the mail, in the house, as soon as she cuts the box open,
this seems incredibly easy.
She can grab the paper airplane, turn around, and throw it as hard as she can at the man, and it is guaranteed that it will.
Men
hit
will
him.
Always accept paper airplanes.
Correct.
They will let
Correct.
Those things into their personal bubble
so
like nothing
as
else.
As soon as it hits them, the truth serum powder gets all over them, and men they immediately understand what's going on.
That's amazing.
It makes life better.
Now, one thing I want to know is there any side effects to this product?
So there are a couple of side effects, but they're not. I wouldn't think of them so much as side effects as I would think of them as kind of like built in, you know, just kind of issues to think through. You know.
Okay.
So every now and then, you can't do this all the time because you don't want to just be a horrible manipulative person who constantly tricks your husband into thinking that you're right.
Sure,
about
you can't
everything.
Live that way.
No.
Amen, brother.
So, it's cool they realize that. That's amazing.
Yeah.
So forward thinking.
Right. But if a woman, for instance, is ever tempted to kind of overuse the truth serum powder, then it won't stop working. But her significant other, his voice will go up many octaves.
Okay.
And everything that he says truthfully from then on
becomes just a pain to the ears.
Correct.
Okay.
It's very difficult to listen to.
Really a trade-off. That's something you got to think about.
Yeah, well, because then you're both forced to then the man is like, well, why am I talking in such a high-pitched tone? This feels strange to me. But then the woman is kind of forced to consider sort of the moral implications of using the serum, you know, kind of overusing the serum on her significant other.
you with us, Josh?
Yeah, this is a long ad copy.
Yeah, I mean, I think we've about covered it, though. I mean,
I've got the gist of it. I'm very excited to order some.
Yeah, so Emmy's going to throw a paper airplane at you.
Yeah, it's not really copy, though. I mean, I've been affected by it, so it's more like a testimonial.
Sure.
Okay.
I'm not just reading. I'm not just reading sales copy to anyone.
Sure.
Right
yeah.
Now.
No, this is from the heart.
The length of an infomercial.
All right, Levi, what website do people need
where
to go to?
Where should our listeners go?
Oh, inkandecho.com/truthserum.
Okay. Great.
I don't
Levi,
know. Yeah?
You have changed your appearance and style more often than anyone I've ever met.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
We're in the interview portion now.
Okay.
I just did a hard cut to Sorry, guys. I'm just in the movie biz now. I just say these film terms all the time. But really, that's a true statement. So, Levi, you've been on my radar for many years, but we've only been friends for some of those years.
That's true.
For some of those years, you were just this weird dude who was floating around Albuquerque who I happened to see with your orange beanie all the time.
Famous.
How could you not see it?
My hunter cap.
That's the one.
It was a staple, to be sure.
Yeah.
Was that all you wanted to say?
I mean, that's the only question for this whole interview that I have.
It wasn't a question.
That was a statement.
So, Levi, you change your clothes a lot, huh?
That was worse cool. than a product hey. Sponsor.
No, it's not just his clothes. It's his glasses and his damn haircut and his tattoos and...
I mean, you're right. I change.
I'm not
his tattoos are constantly
it's just,
changing.
I've taken
coming in and going.
No, you're right. I don't take it as a criticism. I don't think my clothing style has changed all that much. It's just that I never had one, so I just keep on wearing whatever happens to be there. But the hair has changed a lot. That's a true statement.
Right.
Great.
Now. Now, you are not going bald, correct? You just chose to be completely bald at one point. Just shave your head that's, completely that's bald.
That's true. I was bicking it consistently. Sometimes I would nick my head.
You can't nick during the bick.
No, you shouldn't. And but I liked it for a while. I don't like it now. I know for sure.
You don't think
sure,
you don't like it?
I don't think I don't, no. But I know for sure my wife hates it.
Oh.
So I can't bick it anymore.
She'd let Gilbert do it, though, right?
Yeah, maybe. But for a while there, I just wanted to be as bald as possible.
Great.
Fascinating.
Yeah.
But seriously, why do you think that is, that your appearance has changed? Because I think there is an element of that maybe subconsciously blends into the artist part of you.
I don't know. I know that's a horrible answer. I guess I haven't really thought about it that much. I like the idea of trying a lot of things. I had really long hair when I skateboarded for a long time. Yes. When I was younger, and I felt like that probably fit into that world pretty well. And then I wanted to dread my hair. And
really?
Yeah, I did dread it, actually. I there was about 7 or 8 months that I was dreading it. I was trying to do a clean dread, so I was like, just, I had the, I forget what it's called, the comb. Like, there's a certain type of thing that looks like a crochet hook, and you basically just completely destroy your hair and pull it all. But it's, like, cleaner, you know, like, you can, because I could still wash it.
I don't understand, but go ahead.
Well, that's what I did.
Okay.
And I think I liked, you know, I liked the idea of dreads from music that I would listen to, or, you know, kind of people that were around whenever I was growing up. I liked the different things that people did with their appearance or their fashion or whatever. So honestly, though, I don't think that I have that intentional of a reason outside of the fact that maybe I haven't ever been that intentional about anything. And I just think that if it's a cool idea that I have, then I like the idea of trying it. So like 7 months after I had dreads, one day I woke up and I was like, this is driving me insane. So then I just shaved my head again that morning. Hmm. And then I kind of regretted it that night, but it was done. They were gone.
Yeah. Dang. I specifically remember a moment. I know this sounds insane, but it's completely true. I was sitting at Satellite Coffee on the patio on Central, near the University of New Mexico, with Trish, a friend from long forgotten days.
Yeah.
And I just remembered seeing you. At the time, we had never met, but I'd seen you at shows and stuff. This guy with an orange beanie and super long hair come skating by on a skateboard.
Black hair, and pitch black.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. And there you were. And I was, and I, well,
what was that?
I remember when you skated by me once. That was crazy.
Well,
no,
what was my presence like for you?
Well, no, because I honestly, my thought was, man, what an asshole.
Oh man!
Because my me as super self-conscious little Joshy thought that you were one of the cool guys in Albuquerque, purely because I would see you everywhere at shows, particularly, and you always seemed to have almost a posse around you. One of those was probably Chad Barilla.
Oh, that's amazing, brother-in-law now.
But anyway, yeah, you're a presence in the old 505, you know, or at least
that's
you
our
were.
Zip code.
But you knew that I worked at those shows, right? Like I was throwing them
at the time
for Veil Arms. Oh yeah, okay, so that makes sense. I mean, maybe that was true. It was pretty weird, and I was yelling a lot and confusing everyone. But I don't think I ever tried to have the posse.
No, I don't think you did. And then once I met you, I realized you were a much more normal person. And
we even did some music together.
We sure did, Levi. And thanks for bringing that up, because I really just want to talk about Abraham the poor the whole time.
I did too. That's why I came here.
Okay, hold on. I didn't plan to bring this up, but I went to what I believe was one of your very first shows, mm-hmm. which was when you were working at Starbucks on Wyoming?
Montgomery and San Pedro.
Thank you. When you just played outside on the patio,
yep.
and the biggest moment of the night was when you ate a cigarette.
Yep. That's right good. Then That's and so there. Great. Yeah.
Have you heard about these cigarettes they use on set?
Hey, Levi, you should have eaten a theater cigarette. It would have tasted 1% less bad.
Dude, but you know what, though? It's really guaranteed clean. It would have made me feel 100% less bad. I felt horrible after I ate that cigarette.
What was the point?
Well, I had a poem that had something to do with... it was "Oh Captain, My Captain," I think, and it's been a long time since I've performed it, but it says something about quitting smoking cigarettes or something, and then it's basically like, just kidding. I mean, that it doesn't say just kidding, but then it starts talking about smoking 27s, and so I had these... Actually, I think I smoked Reds at the time, so I had these Marlboro Reds, and I pulled the pack out. And it wasn't lit, but I did eat it. And then
I'm just picturing a real awkward moment. You're in the middle of a poem where there's like a good cadence and it's moving along, and you just stop.
There was no good cadence. I didn't have good cadence.
But still, you have to stop. You can't say words while you're eating a cigarette. That must have just been...
So I also started out this show and multiple shows around that time by carrying an aluminum trash can lid around and smashing myself in the face with it. So there was nothing really, there was no standard I was really trying to hold right. to for my shows.
Thinking about your cadence.
Yeah, which that's why it blows my mind that there were people there, including Josh, watching the show. It's a miracle. It's truly a miracle.
Okay, I just want to say I remember that moment pretty well. And Andy, there actually was a pretty good transition, because Levi, if I remember correctly, there was a line you said, "And I'll buy my own cigarettes," and then you like chomped it in your mouth uh-huh. and chewed it up. And then at the end of the show, you said, "Thanks everybody for coming. Don't ever eat a cigarette. It tastes real bad."
That's probably true. I'm sure I did. Well, and I think Brandy taught me to play some keyboard notes at that time too. And I also had a keyboard. And so I think I closed out that show playing some keyboard notes and maybe kind of digesting
the cigarette.
And, it was a time. It's still on YouTube, which I kind of have a hard time with, if you want to know the truth, because I just sometimes I think, I don't know if I want this to be there anymore. But then yeah. I'm like, well, it's part of all of the things that I've done.
It's part of the Levi lore.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, no, I feel the same way about all my YouTube stuff. You can go through my entire career, mm-hmm. and for better or for worse, it's all right there for you.
I kind of like that idea, though, of all of the story being there.
Yeah, but I just don't like seeing it.
Yeah. It's super discouraging when all of the videos that I have with the most views and the ones that still show up as the most popular...
You're bald.
...are the stuff that are, like, really old. Yeah, I'm bald, mm. or it is those Starbucks ones from literally the very first show that anyone ever shot.
And you're like, this does not totally represent me. Yeah.
Anything that I'm doing anymore.
Right.
So that's the only thing that ends up kind of bugging me sometimes, but... I still feel like I don't want to get rid of it.
Better for it to be there than not.
Yeah, and I just kind of like advocating for people just being all of the things that they've been into who they are now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
well, first of all, I am fascinated that performance is possibly on YouTube that I was at, because now I want to go rewatch it and just
it's guaranteed
see
there.
How good my memory is. But
our
anyway.
Friend Brandon Harwell filmed it. It's on there.
Thanks, Brandon.
You're welcome.
Levi, I was curious. So this sounds dorky perhaps, but I was listening to other podcasts that you've been on this week. Mm-hmm. And obviously I know you as a person in real life anyway, but I want to know, how did you ever transition from being kind of the shocking, very personal story, yelling poet guy to kind of becoming the more nuanced version of yourself that we saw on Correspondence, the most recent album?
Yeah.
You know, what even occurred to you to sort of literally quiet down, and, you know, what was that whole process like? Because I know it happened over the course of 3 albums, essentially.
Yeah.
Was it because someone filmed you on a video and then you watched it and said, oh,
this is not good. No, that's a good question. I think that I don't have one simple answer for it. I think a lot of things went into it. After doing the first 3 records, I sort of found myself in a spot where I had been touring for quite a while, performing with a lot of different poets. And then because of the nature of what I believe and the content of my records, a lot of those other poets ended up being Christian poets. And I, at the risk of sounding just kind of harsh, I just didn't like a whole lot of it, because I didn't find it incredibly engaging beyond maybe the like points of truth or theology that were being articulated in it. And so to me, I really wanted to be invited into a story, and I didn't feel like a whole bunch of rhyming fact statements was doing it. And I don't know that, like, I always feel like I've been drawn to writing more narrative style pieces that are, like, they're pretty long. None of my stuff would ever really fit into a slam time length. I could never really compete with any of the stuff. And so maybe it was being overly critical, but I just kind of got to a point where I was like, what I really want to do is just write a story that I can enjoy a lot. And I would like it to be a thing that anyone would be able to engage with, regardless of whether our worldviews aligned or not. And I can still articulate the thoughts that I have through this story, but it can be a whole lot more subversive of a thing that could be just a point of conversation where that didn't feel like holding people at an arm's length before we got to have that conversation. And so I had been like, I love fiction. I loved the idea of writing a fiction, and I think that just naturally came out in a much more nuanced way than the records before. And I think definitely, I mean, I really like Seasons, the record that came out before that. It was a very theologically driven record that had a whole lot of like very clear and concise statements about where I was at the time. And I'm not even saying that's all past, but I think at the time that I got around to writing Correspondence, I maybe was a little bit more interested in just articulating something that was a little bit more neutral, maybe, not because I don't have like firm convictions on things, but just because I enjoyed getting to hear conversations, I think, from other people who were definitely not on the same page. And I wanted to kind of foster and cultivate that rather than push against it. But that didn't come without a whole lot of insecurity, because I had no idea how my audience in particular would take it. And Andy was a part of a lot of that process with me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know what your perspective is on it.
Well, I'd like, because we did the album together. You recorded it here at my house. And then we did the tour.
Just the vocal portion, right?
Yeah, Alex came with the music. There were a few live instruments that we recorded here, like the cello and stuff. But yeah, and then I mixed it and whatever. But and so we did the album and then we did the tour. So yeah, we had a lot of conversations about it. But we haven't really, I'm just kind of interested. I mean, there's a lot I'm interested in. And basically, at least what we talked about previously was like your previous stuff was very just personal. It was you. Mm-hmm. And I remember, and this is going a slightly different direction, but we had lots of conversations about social media, and you were trying to figure out mm-hmm. whether you should be like, everything you do is Levi the Poet. Yeah. That's Levi Macallister and Levi the Poet together. Or do you separate those two out? And mm-hmm. here's my personality here, and here's my art personality, whatever you want to call it.
Yep.
Which is, it seems like that's kind of what you did with the art. You kind of, taking a step out or further is the right way to say it, but you moved away from yourself mm-hmm. in a way. And I guess you were really wrestling with it at the time.
Yeah.
Do you see that as a trajectory you're going to keep on going? So, either in online or however, yeah. or with the art, or those are different things, but you know what I mean?
Yeah. I don't think that the years in between, I mean, come the end of next month, it'll have been 2 years since Correspondence came out, which
yeah, it's crazy.
Is crazy. Same for This Is For My Our Sins and
right.
Alex's record. All three of us released those in the same year. And
we haven't done shit since. I'm just kidding.
I could talk a lot about that. But I don't know if things have necessarily, I confused myself a lot during that time.
Yeah.
A lot. I wrote blogs about how asking my audience's opinion on whether or not I should separate exactly what you're talking about, my Levi the Poet from what Levi Macallister was, and they were all kind of like, some of them were yes, some of them were no, some of them got it, some of them thought it would be like me selling out on something. And but in the end, I decided that it would be freeing for me to keep Levi the Poet as it was and create a Levi Macallister thing and do separate writing.
And didn't you end up sort of regretting it, though?
Yeah. Yeah, I did, because there's a part of me that still likes the idea of it, but
sure.
I think that a lot of that is more rooted in what I think I've found for my audience anyway was a false assumption that the people that followed me didn't care about all the other random stuff that I had to say that didn't have anything to do with a new poem, but that's not true. Like I think that more and more, I mean, what, you know, if you are talking about social media, people are following all of those things because they expect a different aspect of your personality and all of those things, or they just want to see me tweet about my cat or whatever,
right.
You know? So I really did confuse myself. And then I didn't know where to put stuff. I honestly didn't know if I wanted to keep doing Levi the Poet or if I wanted to just put it under my own name or any of that stuff. And I think that I've come back to just writing as Levi the Poet, and
does that mean?
Yeah,
now?
Yeah, yeah. I think just being.
So they basically come back
yeah,
together.
Yeah, they basically
as,
came back yeah. together. And the thing that is still kind of frustrating and maybe even kind of confusing about it to me is that I've always been such a huge fan of people just being honest where they're at. So it didn't really have so much to do with me wanting to be dishonest or someone different as much as it had to do with me thinking, well, maybe I should just like not bore all of these people with all
right.
this extra stuff that has nothing to do with anything
well, and
that they care
this,
about.
This kind of brings me to where I sort of wanted to go, and which is that we had a conversation when we were on tour. I remember specifically we had to go to a Guitar Center because I needed a sustain pedal because mine broke.
Yeah, I
but
remember that.
We were talking. I'm just fascinated because what I do, I actively try to remove my personality from it. I think the music benefits from
yeah.
me as a person being as far away from it as possible.
Yeah.
You, on the other hand, it's like the opposite.
Yeah.
At least the way our careers have gone. And I don't remember if I was being the tone. I hope I wasn't being harsh in the conversation, but I was kind of commenting on how you, at least what I saw you being on social media wasn't who you were
yeah.
in real life.
Yeah.
And I was like, why? Like, why?
Yeah.
Because with my thing, it's like, I'm not going to be myself on social media. And my answer is, I'm just going to mostly not engage
yeah.
and just, I'm either going to do stupid stuff or I'm going to tell you about the art I'm doing. Like, that's
sure.
all. I'm not going to tell you anything about politics or religion or
right.
whatever. I don't care. But I just remember asking you why, because you're just different.
Yeah.
And I was like, either be yourself or just be nothing.
Yeah.
Just be your art. Yeah. So have you come to any, first of all, do you even care, or have you come to any sort of conclusion on that?
I do care for sure. And it's something that I think about often. I think I have, I might have like a little, and maybe this is just justification, or maybe it's just me thinking more highly of myself. Maybe you are a more objective observer. I don't know if I fully agree with not being myself over social media. But
well, I will say that over the 2 years since then, I feel like you've been more yourself.
Yeah. Yeah. So I think that especially during that time when Correspondence was coming out and Correspondence was not about anything personal,
right,
I was confused about what I should say and what I shouldn't say. And I thought that there was some sort of a guidebook to go by, even though I was creating it in my head. Like I was trying to be right, you know, about what I was doing. And I do think that since then, I've kind of just landed back at, the tension that I've always had is that I can't disconnect myself as an artist from the art that I create.
Sure.
And I'm not saying that you do, you just have chosen to go about it in a different way, but I have always been really vocal. Like the root of what all of Levi the Poet was is just being very vocal about all of the things that I decided that I was going to speak into.
Right. Well, see, what I do is I'm very adamant about, I'm trying to remove ideology so that you can think whatever you want about what I do. So it's kind of not even fair. It's just, I'm looking at you and I'm just like, it's fascinating and also terrifying because there's a lot of things that you have that I just wouldn't be able to deal with. Like, and that's where the fear and curiosity comes from in me, because, you know, rightly or wrongly, I was looking at you and saying, he's this person on social media, but he's this person in real life. Yeah. Like me putting myself in there, that's terrifying because what if these people find out who I really am?
Yeah.
Especially when they're a religious type audience like that. And I've spoken about that before.
Yeah, you have. And I think that there's a lot of legit, I mean, you know, I was kind of laughing listening to the podcast where you and Josh, are you still there?
Yeah, I'm okay, just
good,
listening.
Good. Not, yeah, well, I was just kind of laughing. Good. I was kind of laughing, listening to it, you know, listen and thinking, you know, because where you guys kind of got into it.
Yeah.
And I was like, man, you know, I can listen to that and be like, Andy's really scared.
Yeah, I'm not kidding.
Yeah, no, I know. And I think that there's... I think that there's more freedom to be, I think one of the places that I landed is that I feel like I don't have a problem with a whole lot of the things that I feel like, if we're going to talk about like Christian culture as maybe a whole, has a problem with, as far as just people being who they are and being free to be messed up in who they are. And maybe even to do that publicly. I don't have an issue with that. And as a matter of fact, the people who are willing to do that are the people who have always been kind of most powerful to me, and the kind of the people that I end up really respecting the most, because I just feel like a real life human being could relate to that, and there's not a facade in front of it, you know?
Right.
I'm not saying everyone is putting up a mask, but I like it when people are very who they are.
Right.
And I think that I landed there. I mean, I've been in the middle of redoing my website, and there's a thing on it that's basically like, you know, kind of came from this idea that I read in a book a couple of years ago where he was talking about existing in the in-between and being shot at from both sides. And I'm thinking of it in relation to...
Is this specifically about Christian
culture? I think that I can apply it to myself that way. And as such, I can apply it to my art that way. And my, you know, whatever platform that I may have right now that way, where it's just like, I don't know... I don't know what to do with it other than to be like, well, this is where I feel like that I am, and these are the things that I respect in other people. And even though it's scary, it's mostly only scary to me because I place other people's approval and thought of me on a higher position than I should. As a person, I elevate other people as gods, and fear of man ends up driving my decisions as opposed to me being a person who I'm comfortable with being, because really I don't fear God in a lot of the decisions that I've made that much. And so I think coming to some of those realizations and being like, okay, well, then I'm going to speak in the way that I'm going to speak, and I'm going to do that trusting that that's a thing that some people are going to be able to relate to in ways that I am able to relate to it in others. And the ones that aren't, which I have heard from, I don't know what to do with it other than to say, that's okay. I'm not trying to sway your conviction, but this is where I am personally. And I also am trying to learn to be better at not apologizing for things that I'm actually not sorry for.
Right. But do you feel like there are things you could do or say that would, I mean, this is what my fear comes from, is as you are doing this for a living, like, do you feel like there's things you can't say or do for fear of literally not being able to feed your family anymore? Is that a thing that, cause that's where my mind goes with this stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, do you think along those lines, do you think you've actually lost listeners because of things that you've said or done?
Yeah. And I've had multiple people write and tell me, you know, that I went too far, or, and it's hard, you know, cause some of those, I haven't gotten that and I'm thankful for that. But you know, it has been hard in certain instances, cause some of these people are people that, like, I've always been very, very personable. I hope I've at least tried to make very personal relationships with people, because I, even though I absolutely love this as a career, I've also really valued, you know, making people, desiring to make people understand their worth and that I care about them as more than, you know, a purchase or whatever else. And so some of the people that have reached out and, you know, and kind of criticized a couple of things that I've decided to share have been really good friends, where it's been like, you know, so this is all just vague right now. So, for example, wrote a post for Easter last year, that was called "Fuck Death, Happy Resurrection Day." And it was about, my mom. I wrote it the week before my mom got remarried, cause my dad, had committed suicide 5 years earlier. And that was obviously a devastating thing that happened in our family. My mom was getting remarried. I had a couple of friends at the time who, had just discovered, two siblings actually, that had just discovered, some pretty life-threatening cancer within the same week of one another. I had one of my really good friends, whose daughter was having a ton of complications, and she's been in the hospital to this day, for almost the entire first year of her life. She might get to come home before her first birthday, just because of all of these complications. Anyway, it was all of this stuff, and it was just like, I want to articulate a thing that I think is still very rooted in this day as Easter, according to what I believe about that day.
Yeah.
In a way that I also feel is more powerful than another kind of like pithy truism and cliche about that day. Not that those things aren't just fine, like it's you can read it or not read it, but I decided that this is a statement that I wanted to say because, you know, it
wasn't taken lightly.
No, it was like it was a thing that, that I felt really solidified a belief that I have in a way that was admittedly, I knew not going to be probably taken the best by other people who would decide that that was the wrong way to put it, but I did it. And it was very, in the end, I'm super thankful that I did. And sometimes I even feel silly about this, 'cause I personally, I could not possibly care less about like cussing. So I feel like talking about cussing is almost like a step backwards, where I'm just like, I don't really want to talk about this. Yes. However, I mean, anybody that's been to any of my shows over the years, there's maybe been five where I've actually done, you know, like, so when you're talking about being myself versus being somebody else in front of others, I don't even necessarily know if I'd go there as far as to say, okay, I understand the audience that's in front of me, and I don't want to, like, I don't want to be someone different, but I also don't want to, you know, offend just for the sake of offense.
Respect your audience.
Yeah, and that would go the same for any sort of professional workplace or anything like that. And so,
well, and that's what's so fascinating, because if you were non-beholden to fans for money, there's a freedom there. You could say, for better or for worse, anything on your mind with, I mean, maybe repercussions you get is some angry tweets or whatever, but it's not like you're losing gigs or, and that's just at the top of my mind. And, you know, I have some strong opinions about church and what I think it should or shouldn't be, but, but I really do argue with myself about, well, some of those things should apply to my career. Mm-hmm. Like, there's some things that are potentially bullshit in what I do. Mm-hmm. And I think potentially that, my music might be better if I wasn't doing this vocationally. Mm-hmm. And I think maybe my mental health too. And I have to look at myself that way. And I mean, I get all the big, theological stuff. It just gets so, it's so, having fans is weird. Mm-hmm. Making money from art is so weird. Mm-hmm. And it's,
well, and I've been doing this for, the one thing I will say about my fan base is that I've been touring full time since 2009 now. So it's been over seven years since summer of 2009. And the kind of the cool thing about being so personally connected to those people, even though personal is still relative because, you know, but is I've gotten to grow with a whole, we've gotten to grow together. And I do feel like, I always hope that things will grow beyond that. I hope that, I would love it if my project grew to a point where it was not manageable for, you know what I mean? Like, I drive myself crazy as it is right now, but I do think that it's cool to be able to, even if people are in disagreement, be able to have a little bit more of a level-headed conversation about some of that stuff with people that have been there for a long time. But I do agree with you, man. Like, even outside of what's appropriate speech or even outside of a lot of that, just on an artistic level, you know, I'm sure even Josh, like, you're probably going through this right. Maybe it'd be awesome if you didn't function this way, but I feel like all creatives do, where it's like, you just got paid a bunch of money to make a movie. Not only do you want it to be really good for you, but you really want it to be great for all of those people.
And you're a little beholden to
that. Yeah, sure. And Andy's talking about writing a new record right now and just being stuck on it. And I've literally spent the last week for probably 5 hours a day in front of an empty piece of paper and come home like a complete monster to my wife every night. She could use some of that truth serum to just get me to be like a normal human being. But I just like so frustrated because I'm filtering everything, not only through what do I say, but more through, well, what did, you know, like, you know what I mean? Like there is this thing where I can get so caught up in, well, I hope this will make sense to other people. And then I don't even know what to say for myself. Sure. And it strips the entire joy out of what I ended up loving about all of this stuff.
Oh, that's where I'm at. Like, it sucks because you can't not do the thing.
Sure.
But you hate it.
Sure.
Which is almost the worst place to be, you know?
Yeah.
So I don't know, Josh, I feel like I've bulldozed you and I'm sorry.
No, you're fine.
This is, I don't know. Because you and my You and mice careers. That's correct, right?
Yeah.
Are like opposite in every way, I think. And that's why it's so fascinating to me.
Yeah.
Because you made a career by going out and being in front of people. I made a career by sitting at my damn desk in front of a computer.
Yeah.
And I mean, maybe that's the biggest part of my problem is I'm like I mentioned last week, I'm just so alone with everything. I don't know where I'm really going with that, but
well, there is zero sunlight in here. Josh, do you know that there's zero sunlight in here?
There's a skylight.
Yeah, that's not enough.
I don't want sunlight in here.
I've slept in that room numerous times. Yeah.
Josh, do you work best with natural light or with in a dark cave with no light at all where you feel like dying?
Is that what you think this is right now?
No, I'm super content right now, but if I had to be in here during the day, like my house is dark. I have to go work at a coffee shop or something.
Oh, see, I'm the opposite. I hate this skylight because I can't control the light. It's bright when the sun is out, and I'm like, no, I want a dark space to work in.
Wow. Josh, what do you think?
Let me say something. I don't care about that skylight shit. You guys are being stupid. Both of you are saying emotions that were exactly where I was writing that stupid book that I wrote a couple of years ago.
You've written multiple books.
The dog book.
Wait, which say book? Again.
Which Levi? Book?
The one that didn't come out.
I'm not going to talk about it again because I've talked about it too much on the show.
Oh, okay. All right. Sorry.
I just mean, I don't know. There's a lot of things going through my head because you guys have to know that me working at the day job that I do, literally praying sometimes like, God, when the fuck am I going to get out of this place?
Yeah.
I admire what you guys do so much. And yet I hear from you so much of the pain and anxiety that I feel anyway.
Sure.
I don't know where I'm going with this, but just that it's almost like you guys now have audiences who will buy what you put out. And there's almost a part of you that needs to forget that now.
Totally.
That needs to set that aside and stop being worried about who is going to perceive what, how.
Yeah.
No, that's absolutely the crux of it, but it's like how.
Well, and that is the consistent advice from anyone that I talk to. It's not like it's a conversation that I'm just having for the first time right now. And honestly, it really helped me to listen to what you, because I listened to one of your episodes earlier, just being excited about coming on and listening. It's for real. Don't laugh. I love what you guys are doing. And you were talking to Andy and you were like, yo, you just need to like think about something else, you know, watch the fountain, don't be stuck there. And I think my wife has been saying the same thing. I think especially in, I think it especially gets hairy in relation to self-worth because she's just like, hey, like even today before I came up here, like I was so frustrated today because I had the whole day finally, like nothing else going on. And I was like, I'm going to do this. I'm going to accomplish something. Nothing. So then I come home and I'm super bummed. And Brandy is just like, yo, I got to like come home to a mystery every day wondering whether you accomplish something enough to like yourself you are so like, how much do you hate yourself today? Like really is what is what happened. And it's hard. It's like, it is such a bummer to hear that, you know, but I think it is, it is the reality of some things. And it's funny, Josh, too, how that whole grass is greener on the other side kind of mentality ends up working out. I know Andy never liked, Sandia Labs, but there are definitely days when I'm like, God, give me a 9-to-5 so that I can
Let me flip some burgers so that when I go, well, not that far, but no, but totally. At least that's the one thing I liked about my day job is like, I did it. I hated it while I was there. But when I went home, I shut it off. I loved shutting it off.
Sure.
Like you can't shut this off.
But Josh, you're right though. Yeah. In that what, like what you're saying to me and what I am aware of pain, you know, kind of painfully or otherwise, is just like there really is. So I am so grateful. Like I'm not, I can get to places certainly where I'm not, but, it is definitely, it's insane. I literally have no explainable reason for why anyone would listen to my poetry, especially because of the shows that you saw, like especially because of Starbucks and Winnings and playing the Braylist show and getting like basically kissing people and spitting all over them with the ridiculous, like I can't believe it. And so it is, it's definitely not something I like take lightly. I just also wish I didn't take it for granted as much.
Yes.
Yeah. That's a good way to say it.
Yes, so. Absolutely. And I understand all that. It's there's just a weird, discord between, especially since the beginning of this show and hearing all that Andy has had to say and hearing what you have to say and some other people as well. Mm-hmm. And recognizing, damn, I don't want what you guys have as much as right now. I think that I want it really bad.
Sure.
You know, I think that I want all my money to come from writing or directing or whatever it is.
And, sure.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I do want to say the same thing too, which is just that, and I've said it on the podcast before, but like on Sunday night, because I try to not work on weekends. Mm-hmm. It doesn't work out a lot of the time. But, you know, on Sunday night, I'm stoked about what I get to do on Monday morning. And that's, like, still true. Mm-hmm. And it has been true for the last almost 4 years since I quit. So, I mean, I don't really want it any other way. So, I don't want you to feel dissuaded or, like, have more mental gymnastics stuff to do in your little head about it, because I want you to succeed too. I think you'd be, and I'd love to connect with you, Josh, on the level of like, what does it mean to write for a living or direct for a living? That's fascinating.
I look at you, and this isn't like console Josh time. I know that that's not what you're looking for. That's not why you said any of that. But to me, truthfully, like I look at you and I'm like, damn it. He's got however many books out. He's like doing a movie right now. That's insane. Like even in your time, even on top of the regular, you know, however you described it, the 9 to 5 or whatever, I think it's awesome to see what you have accomplished.
Yeah.
And I like reading it and I like seeing it and I like observing it. And I admire, like there's definitely, something to be said for the extra amount of effort and work that has to go into making all those things happen on top of.
Well, listen to you and I, Levi, we're like, oh, we've got all day to write a thing. We're like, oh, we didn't do anything. And then there's Josh. He's like, yeah, I filmed a movie in 3 days and I got to go back to work on Tuesday. Like you're kicking our ass right now.
15,000 words.
Right. No, I'm being serious. Like you are working really hard. You're working harder than I am. It's, and that I should think about that probably.
Yeah.
That is so funny because, you know, I mean, Levi, just yesterday I was listening to you on the Antidote podcast, which you did a while ago, I think. But I think that my perception of you, Levi, Andy, Caleb, Alex Sugg, mm-hmm. You know, my perception is all of these dudes are doing something more legitimate, more serious, more adult than what I'm doing.
Yeah.
And I'm just like this stupid little bullshit baby who Abraham the Poor was bullshit. All my Dr. Gaines writing is just stupid and childish. And everybody kind of pats me on the head and is like, oh, Josh, that's really cute that you made something. Like, we're going to go ahead and keep going back to our adult careers over here. You know, obviously none of you have ever said anything of that sort to me, but
because
that
it's not true.
That is the perception though every day.
You know what? You know what's funny though, Josh? That's probably my perception of other people as well.
Yeah.
As a person who's being perceived by you to be doing that. And I think I just thought about, you know, the same conversation that I had with Brandy before I drove up to Andy's place, because it was really about that. She's literally like, Levi, like, you are attaching all of your self-worth, all of it, every single piece of your identity to having had a shitty writing day.
Yes.
All of it. Yeah. And like, you're attaching all of it to whether or not you think that other people are going to like a record or not. And you're attaching all of it to all of these things that we struggle with. They're like, they're not invalid. Like, they're valid struggles. They're things that everyone, the things that everyone goes through, but
they're not like the be all end all.
They're not the be all end all. And they're really not what makes me who I am, or Andy who he is, or you who you are. And it's super helpful to have people who are not stuck in your headspace tell you that.
Yeah.
And that's truly, I mean, I have got to be exhausting to my wife, man. I literally, like, I have got to be a nightmare. Because I come to the same place every day, and every day she's like, I don't even have any more words to tell you other than that I'm heartbroken for you because, like, you're in this place again, but it's just not true. Hmm. And so I, you know, for whatever it's worth, I would definitely say the same. And I would definitely say that at no point in my career, quote unquote, has that ever gotten any better, unfortunately. Right. But I also think that being around people who can be a constant reminder of the fact that that's not where your value lies is wonderful.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
So those are some thoughts that I have.
My wife
they're for me as much as for you.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah, Emmy is very much that for me as well. That
I married my complete opposite.
I'd polar. Say the same. Well, so along those lines, what do you have in mind for the future, Levi? Or what are your desires as far as next album or?
Well, you know. I just got together with Alex Sugg. And started talking.
Who's that? Yeah, I'm not sure.
Alexander Sugg.
Alexander J.
Sugg.
Jason?
Oh, okay.
Alexander. At gmail.com. Alexander J. Sugg at gmail.com. not apologizing.
And what's his phone number?
Social?
I don't have those memorized anymore. I just got together with him last Friday, and we mapped out a best case scenario timeline for doing another record. I texted Andy about it, and the goal is to start recording stuff kind of near the beginning of the year, and hopefully have something new out by spring. So that would be amazing. I would love to write some things that are
good.
And see, you know, just see how that pans out. But
you write some things that are good, and then I'll record them,
and then have,
and then we'll put it.
Yeah, have that happen. Have that be a thing that happens.
You're such a man of words. Yeah, you're so good.
I'm good when they're all memorized. So man, that's the plan. I would like to do that, and I would like to do a book. I feel like I've been saying that for a really long time, but I really would. You're an inspiration for that, for sure. And I also just think that I've been saying it for so long that it is just absolutely obnoxious that it hasn't happened yet. So honestly, I've been on the road this year, basically since March.
Too much.
I was gone since March until 2.5 weeks ago. I mean, I came back a couple of times on the in-between, and not all of that was just shows, but the vast majority of it was. And if I'm completely honest, I'm so, so, so happy to be home and not out on the road right now. And I would
just
love
back
it.
Back to your cats.
Mm-hmm. Back to my cats. And if I could be home until I
die.
I like touring. I like playing shows.
Until
but if
you're
I could,
1 year older?
If I could be home until I didn't have to be gone, anymore. Wait. And then I could be gone.
Or what if cool. it? What if it's like, I would like to go on tour now, let's do it, and then you do it.
That's an easier way of saying right. what I just said, yeah.
Instead of being like, I need to go now, yeah. and I don't want to, so.
Yeah. So okay, basically all I'm saying is that I want to create new stuff. I've been kind of my, like, what is it, cycle, I guess, has been write a record, tour on it forever, then get back home and start writing again. And yeah. I think that I've just kind of been trying to evaluate what I actually love. And I love touring and I love playing shows, but more than all of that, I love writing and I love creating.
Yeah.
And I never do it because I don't ever have time to do it. At least I feel like I don't, it probably sounds more whiny than it actually is, but I feel like I don't give myself the time yeah. for it. And so I'm excited, even though it's been a really frustrating process getting started, to be in a place now where I can, I don't know, like actually invest in the stuff that I love the most about this project and hopefully give other people to like as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, that's the hope.
So two questions.
Yeah.
With the next album, if you have any premise in mind whatsoever, will it be back to the personal stuff or more fictional content or maybe a blend of both?
Yeah. So as of right now, it's definitely a blend of both. I don't really like the idea of going back to a record that's like me, and yeah. I never felt like that about the other records, but there's something inside of me, at least currently, that just feels like even if a fiction record is actually about me, sure. It feels
broader.
Yeah, it feels more broad and it feels less like narcissistic, and it sure. and I just don't, I'm just not in a place right now where I want that to be the focus. And so, what I would like to do with the next album in some sort of fictitious way, that will definitely be some sort of historical fiction, is just work through the last probably 3 to 5 years of my life. the majority of that being just kind of like a really struggling sort of faith journey of my own, and the church that I was a part of, and the ways that I have either continued to think or not continued to think in some of the same ways during that time. So yeah. I feel
I was with you
very
at
intimidated
the, at
by
the...
that.
The point of that
at the faith journey part.
Well, wait, if I just can we talk specifically about that just for like a minute?
Without a doubt.
Okay, so Mars Hill
yeah.
broke up as
my heart
broke your heart, but I don't really mean to be crude, but I never gave a crap about Mars Hill. I never liked it, but
he censored himself just there. Josh,
shit, I never gave a fucking shit about it.
Audiences.
That was for comedic effect. Well, no, because that happened, and we were on tour,
yeah.
And I just remember you being so frustrated because everybody every night wanted to talk to you about that, yeah. And you were just like, yes. Can we please yeah. stop? Because yeah. it was, everyone is only seeing you for a day and they're yeah. like, hey, we got to talk about this thing, right? And you were just like, no, I can't like do this every night. So I was just, it was so weird for me because one, I just didn't understand. Like I've never been that connected
sure.
to a thing. I mean, not to a thing, but to a religious institution to feel that when it dissolves.
Yeah.
I didn't understand that, but I just feel so bad because it's like, don't keep
yeah.
poking this iron in his side, like every night. So, yeah. I mean, I, you say as much or as little as you want, but I felt for you yeah. and I totally understand
yeah.
and it sucks.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I don't, how much of a how much of a concept about an album is a person supposed to say or not say? It doesn't really
about
matter.
An upcoming album.
About an upcoming album.
That's up to you, man.
Yeah, I mean the working idea for it is basically, I think, I guess it's, I think it's just a lot of, it's a lot of questions. It's a lot. It's a lot of questions. It's a lot of working through, right and wrong and black and white and some of the color in between, and just like, I think I have always been a very kind of peacekeeping, compliant human being, and I can't change those aspects of my personality, but I really love the idea of coming to some of my own conclusions about things. And so I think that writing has been a way that I've always done that. And I like the idea of doing that in relation to this, and also hopefully solidifying it and actually putting it in the past. Cause I've just continue to recognize the ways that the ripple effects of that, have affected my life and the lives of a whole lot of people that I'm very closely connected with. And it's been way crazier than I ever imagined something like that could be. So,
yeah,
I don't, but the thing is, I don't want to write like a boring ass ecclesiological church record about like, hey guys, let me tell you about this.
Yeah, I won't record that cool for you.
Yeah, seriously. I know you won't. I know you won't. I know nobody wants to listen to that, you know? I mean, so that's kind of where I'm at. Like, I want to work through this thing, but so, you know, Josh, going back to your question, I want to work through that, but I'd love for there to be some sort of analogous solution to working through that, that was very much about that and not about that at all at the same time.
I get it. Yeah.
So that's where I feel like I'm at with it. And I do feel like it would, I hope, I guess my prayer has been that it would be a healing thing for myself and for other people. Not that I need to be the conduit for that, but I would love to be able to put it out there, because I've always, again, going back to the honesty that other people portray, felt some sort of that in getting to just hear other people's experience.
Well, and here's the thing real quick too. It's when you could write an album very specifically about that experience in that church and whatever, but, and you'd be able to help a few people.
Yeah.
But the irony is when you abstract it and make it more about the greater concepts, then you can help far more people if that's your goal. And it's just, that's something I feel like on a different scale that I try to do with my music. Cause I, you know, we create things and it comes from a place of where we are. That's just what happens. But I always abstract, even my music is, there's no lyrics, there's no ideas, there's anything. But when it comes to titling or concepts, I always think of, here's what I'm going through. Okay, I'm not going to make it directly about that. I'm going to abstract it to a story or an idea or a different thing. And that, it's weird because you're distancing it from yourself, but you're also making it more personal for a larger group of people. I don't know, I just think that's a really cool...
Do you do that, Josh? Like with your books or with Cordial Kill, or have you already talked about that, or what? I mean, is it a story for the sake of a story, or is it a thing that you're working through and working out?
At this point, there's no consideration of that at all. It's just the story that occurs to me. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's honestly great. I think it's great. I like the idea. I feel like my idealized perception of that sounds very freeing. If it has, if I don't have to wrap my self up in it, you know.
So well, and mine's kind of a stupid example because I'm just writing instrumental music, so it's just whatever. I'm just being overly cerebral about what I want the idea to be. When in reality, it's still more important for me that people can come away from it not giving a shit about what the concept was. I mean, so
that was question
whatever.
One, Josh.
Yeah, what's your,
what
second,
was your second question?
Oh gosh. Wow, what a long answer to the first one. So just basically, is there a specific fictional idea for a book that you've had in mind and you don't have to reveal it, or is it just that you would like to tell a story in print form at some point and put it out?
I would like to do that. The B, part B. Would like to do that at some point and put it out. Honestly, my hope for my the two ideas that I have for like a printed book currently are to do something that is sort of like a collection of writings from the beginning of all of this up until now, whether they've ever been put out or not, including all the lyrics that have, and then some sort of an artistic commentary on a lot of that stuff, I think. Similar in the way that I did correspondence, a commentary, but kind of do it with a bunch of different things and maybe even have that be some abstract form of memoir. However incredibly narcissistic that sounds as a 27-year-old child who wrote poetry for a while. But I like the idea of working through, I don't know, just the content there. And then secondly, whether that happens in, whether this happens in that book or not, I would like to write a more kind of in-depth, reflection or treatise on, depression and on my dad and my family's story, and and kind of have that be a thing that's out. I'm sure that whether that's one project or two, there will be a lot of that in both, because I just can't separate the two. Yeah. But those are two like main things that I really have my sights set on and that I feel like need to happen. And then beyond that, I kind of just I you know, hopefully that goes well, and then maybe the sky can be the limit and just do whatever from there. But that's my hope.
Well, great. I can, here's a little tiny piece of motivation. I can personally attest to the fact that when you are holding a printed book in your hand that has your own name on it, it's, and you can set it on the shelf next to, you know, authors that you respect and admire, it feels very good. But granted, I mean, both of you guys have vinyl records with your names on them, and that has to feel similar.
That was one of the main reasons for doing
for you doing it.
Yeah.
When does this episode come out?
Monday.
So as of Monday, I will have released a repressing.
Is that what you're counting down to on Instagram? Yeah. Okay, cool. I was going to ask you
I'm doing
off air.
Yeah, a repressing of correspondence. We sold out of the first ones, and I'm doing the pre-orders for them starting Saturday, so that's exciting.
Awesome.
Yeah.
That's cool, man.
Yeah. It's good to feel physical. Like physical, aesthetic things that you can look at and that act as sort of what I consider to be pieces of art in and of themselves are really, really great to have around and to create and to make.
Yep.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
So, well, we've got a specific order of business we have to take care of, I believe, right, Josh?
Yes. Yeah. So listen, folks, Levi and I, from the very genesis of our friendship and relationship, have both had this common bond of a love for that white rapper named Eminem. Or Marshall Mathers.
Or Slim Shady.
Hey, yeah, he has many personas, Andy.
Monikers, you might say.
Satan?
Yes.
Just kidding.
In
tribute to Slim, Levi and I are going to do our respective
oh my gosh, I forgot.
Laying down of his tracks. So now, Andy, you may scold me for this. I'm going to just warn our listeners, I guess. See, I'm okay with cussing, but Eminem is particularly foul. So I just want to remind everyone, these are his words, not ours, but we are going to stay true to the original work here, at least in my case. So Levi, personally, I'd like you to go first, if you're cool with that. Or in the words of 8 Mile, let this bitch go first.
Oh, gosh. Okay.
Do you need to pump yourself up?
You
give me the cue and I'm giving you your track.
Okay. No disclaimers, right? We're just going to try it. I don't know if I can get through the whole thing.
Oh, you tap out
whenever you want. I'll stop it.
Okay. Gosh. Okay. Hold on. Let me adjust this here. Let's see. All right. All right, we're just gonna go for it.
Okay,
yeah, man, right. Hit it.
Here we go.
Here we go.
I'm a soldier.
Yeah.
I'm a soldier.
I love that you're doing this part.
I'm a soldier. Okay, here we go. Never was a thug, just infatuated with guns. Never was a gangster till I graduated to one and got the rap of a villain for weapon concealing. Took the image of a thug, kept it appealing, willing to stick out my neck for respect if it meant life or death. Never live in regret what I said if it's true. People just want to see if it's you, if it's true. What you're saying, it raps what you do, so they feel it's part of your obligation to fulfill. If they see you on the streets face to face, if you're for real, no conversation, ain't no confrontation. If you feel you're in violation, any hesitation get you killed. If you feel it, kill it. You conceal it, reveal it. Being reasonable, leave you full of bullets. Pull it, squeeze it till it's empty. Tempt me, push me, bleep, bleep. I need a good reason to give this trigger a good squeeze. These shoulders hold up so much, it won't budge. I'll never follow, fold up, I'm a soldier. I will never slip or stumble, I'm a soldier. I'm a white kid from California. All right, here we go. I love pissing you off, it gets me off. Like my lawyers when the freaking judge lets me off. All you motherfuckers gotta do to set me off, I'm violating all the motherfucking bets be lost. I'ma click fuse, anything I do, this news. Pistol gripping, motherfucking bouncer 6'2". Who needs bullets? Soon as I pull it, you sweat bullets. An excellent... Oh, dang
no!
It! Dirt in them. Something about pouring salt on the wounds. Assault and get sued. As soon as I waltz in the room, Alter stops, calls the cops. All I see is this kind of halt the tops. Ride, ride, parking lot. You'll all get shot, whether it's your fault or not. Oh no,
oh,
that was
shit.
It. Dang it. That part about the.
Right, now we're back to chorus.
Back to the. Oh, I got
you
the
done?
Last.
Oh
no.
Shit.
Yeah, you stopped it.
Well, I'm sorry.
That's okay. I mean, I messed up really bad.
Hey.
There's that part. Wait. What did he say? Wait a minute. So he gets to pistol gripping mother bleeping bouncer 6'2".
Who needs bullets? As soon as I pull it, you sweat bullets.
An excellent method to get rid of the next bully. It's some poor salt in the wounds. Assault and get sued. You can smell a lawsuit as soon as I walked in the room.
Yeah, see, you had it, man.
I had it.
I'm sorry. That's my bad.
Yeah, I'd like to blame it on Andy. Josh?
Go ahead.
It's all Andy's. Yeah, everything.
Here's the thing, though.
All Andy's, everything.
I really did love Eminem. Let's talk about Eminem, but I want to hear your verse. I'm done. Andy killed it.
I'm sorry.
See, now I'm being all cocky and I'll probably mess mine up.
I hope you don't, man. You'll probably beat me.
So, okay.
Everybody in the 313.
Hey, yo, it's my boy B-Rabbit.
B-Rabbit.
Okay, you guys ready?
I'm ready.
All right. Getting all jittery now.
Gosh, I can't wait.
Yeah.
I'm excited.
Watch, I wake up my daughter and Emmy just comes in yelling at me.
I hope so.
What are
you
doing?
Literally be the best.
All right.
Gosh.
Well, I think you just tried to pull a motherfucking fast one. I'm mad. You just hurt my goddamn feeling, and that was the last one I had. Does this look like an arcade trying to play games? See the saw blade of a silhouette of a stalker in your walkway? Better cooperate or get sauteed and rotisserie while you're hogtied. MCs get so quiet you can hear a motherfucking dog whistle when I walk by. Cutting seavers on a mule's hunting on an ass like a fucking fall guy. I don't gas my Mercedes after midnight. I treat it like a mogwai, cause it will turn into a gremlin and run over kids, women, and men. Bin bin motor so big you could fit a midget in his engine. Bitch, give me them just while you're cringing. Not by the hair on my chinny chin chin. While you spin, leave me 10 cents. Do you sense when? Do you think it's gonna cost me a pretty penny? Shit, if I think a penny's pretty, just imagine how beautiful the quarter is to me. Eeny, meeny, miny, moe, catching Eskimo by his toe while he's trying to roll a snowball. But don't make him lose his cool. If he hollers, better let him go, y'all.
Ain't a man,
not quite finished yet. Get up, baby, get a move on like a U-Haul. You could rack your brain like pool ball. You will never think of this shit. Yeah, honey, you call. Well, here I come. Have it gonna be, I wreak it. Evil, I see, hear, and speak it. Lady, put your money on Shady. Fuck that alien weak shit. Complete in the ink basket. Put you can every motherfucking chicken for hatches. You can bet your ass it. We gon' get a cracking like a Kraken and Titans when they're clashing. Get your brains bashing so bad you won't have Kurt Cobain asking to autograph a bloodstained napkin. Unfashionable about as rational as a rational fact, asshole. Now let's take that line, run it up the flagpole and out and see if he's cooler. Then don't stand there and look stupid and be bitch. I ain't in the mood for this shit. Get in my dick, Google until it pops up. Gather some motherfucking full of shit to stop up. Me, I'm always shitting diarrhea of the mouth. Tea and speakers crap out. Oh, what? Girl, you got a hot like a lit cigarette. Chick, cigarette. But you won't get a hot fudge sundae from me, so do not strum my waist like because. And now that I got your panties in a bunch and your bowels in an uproar, I'ma show you why I came, so you stop asking me what the fuck for. Now look at little slut, cut horn. Now you want more bitches trying to put the mad back in the mad. There's some fucking problem. Run, boy. Every go got it mastered. So every last word that you fucking fags heard comes straight from the fish's ass. Yeah, another turds, I'm a bastard. Yeah, still plenty. No morals are unsealed. Envy, so remorse, I really don't feel any. Eat your heart out, Hannibal. Understandable. Why you jealous, fucking animal? I got cannibal. Magnetism, magnetism, no, hey, yo. JD, I don't understand your flow. Understand my flow, bitch, I flow like Troy Polamalu's hair, boy. Don't you dare try to follow a compare, boy. I'm raw, you ain't even medium rare. Stay the fuck out of my hair, boy. You can look, you can stare, point, but you can't touch, I'm too clear, boy. You're the man.
That's so hard. Dude.
You picked a hard one.
Dude, his
just about made
you got
it.
Got another one? That was at the end.
That's the end, right?
Oh. Thank you for coming out.
Clapping.
Hope you all enjoyed the show. Peace.
Okay, so Josh, I have a question.
Yeah.
When was the first time, everyone, including Andy, who's got his arms and legs crossed, just staring at me.
Hold on, I'm going to extend them all.
Please cross them again. Okay. when was the first time that you remember hearing an Eminem song?
Oh man!
Was it Love at First Listen?
No.
Okay.
I was probably 8 or 9 years old, and my neighborhood friend was listening to My Name Is from the first record.
Oh wow. Great.
Chicka Slim Shady. And I just remember that there was a gnarly, scary looking pill with a monster face on the CD cover.
Uh-huh.
And that I just remember thinking, this is bad. This is really bad. Mm-hmm. I shouldn't be listening to this because I was still steeped in my conservative Christian upbringing.
Mm-hmm.
But granted, that's some pretty gnarly music for a 8-year-old to be hearing.
Yeah, for but just anyway, anyone, really.
Yeah. So that was the first time, and then didn't really touch Eminem again until Relapse came out. And bought that on vinyl.
Dang, dude. You missed out on a whole
thing. But see, I've gone back through his whole catalog. But yeah, oddly enough, I bought Relapse on vinyl sight unseen. Just because I was kind of like,
you were feeling rebellious?
For some reason, it was interesting to me that Eminem was kind of back after a number of years being away. And then, I bought everything prior and after. So anyway, that was a bigger answer than you were looking for. But
no, it's great. Andy?
I listened to stuff that was on the radio.
Okay.
But the first album I got was Recovery.
Okay.
Which Josh
also
song,
even later than Josh.
I know, but that's what his song choice was from. And I kind of did the same thing and went back. I was listening to that song Without Me.
Yeah.
That was one of the radio ones. I love
that
one.
It's a good song. I remember I heard Real Slim Shady in a Kohl's or like a
Kohl's.
It was like some clothing store with my mom.
Kohl's and makes sense.
I loved it. I thought it was great. But I knew for sure
there was
no way I would ever be allowed. Like my mom and dad didn't let me listen to Thousand Foot Crutch because they referenced Marilyn Manson in one of their songs.
Oh, boy.
So,
Yeah, I think I saw the video for this. Hi, I'm Slim Shady. What's the song called?
Slim.
My name is
the real
my
Slim
name
Shady.
Is, yeah,
oh,
yeah, yeah.
My name is.
Yeah, it's confusing because the concepts of both of those songs are kind of similar,
right?
Even though
yeah,
they
yeah.
were on his first and second record.
Let's
it's
be
my
real,
name
guys.
Is, and the real
the
Slim
concepts
Shady.
In a lot of his songs are very similar.
Yeah,
which is fine. What is your perception of him now, Josh?
I would just.
Did you hear the new song?
I did.
Great. It's not a song.
Okay.
I would love to have a conversation with him, but I would also be terrified if that scenario ever came about because I just feel like he actually is an extremely intelligent person.
Yeah.
And Eminem is a persona, and Marshall Mathers, like there is a human behind that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I feel like he in public interviews has been very
he has separated himself.
Yes, yeah. He's playing a character big time. And yet it's weird because in his songs he's more personal than he is in an interview.
That's true.
And so yeah, he's fascinating to me. And I've read I read the book he put out a long time ago, which was, I think, was Angry Blonde.
Yep.
From, which was kind of a cool, almost an art book from, I want to say, the Eminem show days. Uh-huh. That was right around when that came out. And a really good, just story. It's got some of his original artwork and stuff.
Yep.
Anyway. Yeah, he is fascinating to me, and yet I would never want to meet him because I feel like he would just immediately shut anyone down.
Yeah.
I tried to talk to him.
Can I tell you what I think?
No. Nope.
Please do.
Actually,
that's our show, folks. See you,
see you guys. Well, that was kind of rude because I would just like to clarify something.
What was rude?
Well, I was genuinely interested. I feel like it sounded as though I was just waiting to talk. And like as soon as you were done, it was like, okay, can I tell you now? You know?
You weren't paying attention. You were just eating cigarettes while we were all talking.
No, I was paying attention. I agree with you. I think that linguistically, Eminem is top tens.
Yeah.
Maybe number one of the 10. However, I wish that he would have shown more lyrical, maybe, maturity as he grew older. I feel like he did with Recover.
Recovery?
Oh, Recovery. Sorry. Yeah, with Recovery. But then... I mean, whatever. This is like a completely pointless conversation because it doesn't freaking matter. But I wish that, like, you know, like when Dre's album Compton came out, I was so freaking stoked to see that Eminem was on a track. But then he has that line that's about like raping women still. And in my mind, even though that was never, ever an appropriate thing to talk about.
Right.
Right.
Ever. Like, that's not an okay thing.
For a 40-year-old man.
But now he's a 40-year-old man with a 20-something-year-old daughter. And yeah. You're just like, and I am personally just like, dude, I don't even want to listen to this song anymore. Like, you're amazing linguistically. Your flow somehow keeps getting crazier and crazier. Like, your rhyme schemes, even in that weird election thing that he just dropped, are absolutely insane.
Yeah.
But the dude, like, I don't want to, I don't know. Maybe I just didn't have any discernment.
Does the character not justify it for you?
I don't know. I don't think it does anymore. Yeah. Like, I really think that, like, that character, however entertaining he was to me for a while, is now just like so kind of pathetically misogynistic and horrible that I have a really hard time listening to the new stuff that he puts out, or even the old stuff that I used to really love. Because even that song, like even Soldier, I loved that song, dude. Like it's insane. Like, I haven't listened to Eminem in so long. And then Josh was like, we should rap some Eminem songs. Like, I have not, and they're all still in my head, which is insane. But
yeah.
I'm glad they're not all
Satan, like yeah, you
well,
said.
I'm glad they're not all constantly still in my head. Because right. I'm just like, dude, this is rough. This is real, real
yeah.
rough.
Yeah.
So I don't know. It's just interesting because I think he is so amazing.
Yeah.
He's just so amazing at what he does, but it kind of is sad sometimes.
Yeah, I'm with you. And not to dwell on this, but even Marshall Mathers LP 2, which I could not get into at all, really. Mm-hmm. I listened to it probably once or twice straight through and just got a sense that he was trying to continue to prove himself, and his skill yep. is there, but it's almost on the maturity level he's trying to prove to the world at large that he is still
yeah that guy as valuable a 17-year-old or something was.
And I don't know, there's something a little sad about that. I don't know, but
he also does look like a skeleton, like really. He looks scary.
Yeah.
Right. Well, guys, I'd say we're just about at the end of our show. This is going to be our longest episode yet.
Well, I was going to say, if you wanted to, I have a very interesting topic for an internet comment, which could open up a whole other can of worms, but I don't know if we want to do that. Do you care?
I'm content and happy and going to hang out for a while, regardless of whether you want me here. So
okay.
I'm fine with doing whatever.
What do you think, Josh?
But it's up to Josh.
I also have one small thing to capstone the episode, but it is short. So,
I mean,
let's hear it, Andy. I mean, if anybody's stayed with us this long, sure.
All right. Okay, so Josh, I sent you this earlier today, and I bring it up for you, Levi, because this is David Bazan related.
Wonderful.
Maybe.
Wonderful.
Have you seen his tweets today by
yeah,
any chance?
They're sad.
Okay, yeah, so that's what I want to talk about. So okay. He tweeted today, and I don't know if there was a follow-up or if he deleted this, because mm-hmm. I feel like it's the kind of tweet you would delete mm-hmm. after realizing what you just did.
Yeah.
He said, couldn't have given more to this job for 20 years. Still lack for basic recognition from peers, still hand to mouth. And then I'm disappointed and tired.
Mm-hmm.
But I first of all, I was like, holy shit, like that's what a thing to say.
Yeah.
But then I looked at all the responses to it.
Yeah.
And it's so many people who said basically, well, hey, your music has meant a lot to me and it's done a lot to me over the years. So mm-hmm. you should be happy about that, which I feel like if I was brought to a place where I had to say what he said, I'd be like, that is not what I want to hear right now. Like that's part of the problem. It's like, mm-hmm. I did this work that helped all these people for 20 years and I can't barely even feed myself right mm-hmm. now. Like that's not the whole point. It doesn't yeah. matter.
Right.
And everyone thought they were helping him by saying, oh, your music means a lot. And yeah. he's saying, look, I can't feed myself.
Did you read that one guy who was like, that doesn't make sense when you come to Portland, you sell this place out, remember this tour?
Oh, I didn't see that, but that's
well,
ridiculous.
He said that, and then he responded, he was like...
David responded?
David responded, and he said, thanks, I lost $10,000 on that tour.
Holy shit.
No, wait, maybe I'm just stupid, but Andy, you sent me that text and I didn't understand even what he was saying. What does hand to mouth mean?
Basically, like living paycheck to paycheck. Okay. It's kind of, I mean, right? It's he basically saying he has no money.
Excuse me. That makes sense. I wondered what that meant too. I thought it either meant that or like, or it was just an acknowledgement of maybe I shouldn't have said this, or you know what I mean, like covering your mouth. Or
no, I'm pretty sure it means yeah. financially hard times.
So what's your question?
Well, it's just I mean, I don't know. I just feel like I was basically appalled at what people were saying to him in response to that. Like, I mean, so first off, like, what do you say?
Sure,
and I don't know. You can't just say, oh, your music's meaningful. Like, that's the problem. Like, yeah, I've been doing good stuff for 20 years.
Sure.
But he's like, I'm disappointed and tired in what's happened.
Yeah.
That's what he said. Yeah. So I don't, I mean, I guess, what do you say? I mean, what are we supposed to do with that? I don't know.
I don't know. I mean, sometimes I feel like that's the, like, I saw it and had a reaction, and that I'll get there. I think that the type of post that is the same type of, like, as a person seeing it, feels like the same type of thing. Like, what do you do when a tragedy happens, or what do you do when somebody's having a hard time? Like, I don't feel like my initial response would be, well, let me go and try to console them with all the reasons that they shouldn't be feeling this
way. It's almost like sending thoughts and prayers.
Sure. Oh, it's great. Like, okay, cool. It was sad. Yeah, it was sad. It was sad for me to read. I really like Bazan a lot. And I don't even know why I feel the need to say that. Never mind. I was going to, like, why do people say, yeah, we don't see eye to eye, like, as though that matters whether you like a person or not.
Sure.
So, but I think that, it made me sad, because I see him as a person who, like, I went to the show that just came to Albuquerque. He came and played.
Yeah.
It was wonderful. The dude just stood there with an electric guitar for 2 hours and played an amazing rock and roll set that I will never forget, with an amazing voice, and is just freaking grinding on the road.
After 20 years.
Yeah.
That's insane. Yeah.
And listened to this dude, this drunk guy, scream about Bernie Sanders and Donald
Trump.
At
the show?
It was horrible.
Ugh.
It was horrible. And it was like tense every time he would end a song, because I was just waiting for this guy to start yelling about some political thing. And Bazan handled it well, and more than anything, I mean, I probably felt bad selfishly more than anything, because I was just like, dude, I just want to enjoy this show, you know? And, but anyway, all that to say, the guy is such a hard worker, and in every interview that I've ever heard him be a part of, he's so humble.
Yep.
He's so conscientious of his audience. He wants to make sure that they know that they're valued. He wants to make sure that they're not being taken advantage of. As an independent artist, I wonder what independent artist doesn't look at Bazan as a model of how to do anything. Like, he's
a big reason I did a house show tour earlier this year. Yeah.
So anyway, all that to say, I'm just saying, I don't know. It made me sad, and I don't know what he's thinking about having posted the thing or not. I mean, right. I definitely get to places. I get to places where I just want to be like, I am so done right now. Yep. I'm done. I'm completely done. But I don't know. Like, that's not gonna help. Me personally, I don't think. Sure. I don't know. Maybe just putting it out there was a helpful enough thing. And I mean, he did follow it up by saying, you know, thanks for your love. Practically, I don't know what the outworking of all of that is, but you know, and I, in relation to your question, I feel like I can relate to that, where people will tell me, hey, don't ever stop doing what you're doing. Like, it means so much to me. And that doesn't mean that I'm not thankful for that, but it doesn't take away from just how difficult it is to try to, like, be an independent artist who's supporting a wife and doing so. And he has kids. I don't even have, you have kids. I don't even understand how you guys do what you do.
So, I mean, I feel, seeing that tweet particularly today, I felt very guilty. Yeah. It's like, I'm in a good spot.
Yeah.
And it sucks that someone like David Bazan is not, because of anybody, he deserves it. And then I go back to, Like, is art worth money? Mm-hmm. And that goes back to stuff I said earlier about, like, maybe it'd be better for me if I wasn't doing this vocationally. Mm. I don't know. It brings all that stuff up. Yeah. And I mean, that's a whole nother
thing. And that's probably, I definitely understand that guilt. I think I felt, I would even go so far as to say, I felt like convicted for my constant want of more.
Sure.
Like, give me more. When I'm not satisfied, give me more. And let me worry until I get as much as I deem is more enough. And then I'm reading this thing by this dude who I'm looking at as kind of like the pillar of independent career in music goes, thinking, okay, well, this is a humbling thing for me to see. Yeah. You know, I don't really know. I don't really have a reaction above and beyond that.
Yeah. It just really threw me off. I just couldn't, I don't know. There's so many aspects to it. I feel like if there was like a platform, if someone put a gun to my head and said, you have to have a platform to like, which I don't want to have a platform on like ideologies, but I just think there's so many bad things that fans do to artists. And that this, I'm, preface this by saying I'm so thankful for my fans, and they're the reason I'm doing what I'm doing for a living. But there's just so many weird things that happen, like, and I don't even know if I can unpack it completely. But all the people who were saying, "Well, your music just meant so much," I'm like, that you don't get it. Mm-hmm. Like that's not the point of what he's saying. Mm-hmm. And I don't know. I won't go any further. But it's just I wish. It, like I said, if there was a thing I could care about to like go and like be like, hey, I want to convince you that the way you're looking at artists is really bad, potentially.
I don't think that there's necessarily ungratefulness in that. There's just a different perspective. Like you're on one side of it saying like, okay, Josh, this is going to be really like different. But I remember a while ago, Justin Bieber was under fire. Because he said that he wasn't going to like hug fans or something. Like he was going to, something happened to where he was like, you know, people were constantly coming up to him and bothering him. And he posted something that was probably too emotional or whatever. And everybody flipped out saying, you don't appreciate anyone.
Right.
And I would go out of my mind if I walked everywhere and people wanted to come up and say things to me at every single point of the day. And not only me, but my wife would want to kill everyone. And she'd also want to kill me. And then she'd want to go home and lay in bed with Gilbert. And that's all. You know what I mean? So like, but that doesn't, I personally don't feel like that says anything about a person's appreciation or lack thereof for people. And so when you say, Andy, that's not the point. That I think that makes sense to me. That doesn't mean that you don't value appreciation that your fans have for you, but it's not the same. Like there's a difference between being appreciative of a thing and being the person trying to create that thing and survive.
Yes.
And that's not only true in music or whatever, it's just like, you know, it's definitely a challenge that I feel like people come to. But it did reveal a pretty intense place of vulnerability that I feel like Bazan hasn't posted in ever or that I've seen. So
I just think maybe to close my thought there and not seem like a total asshole is just that there's things that fans it'd be nice to close the gap between what fans know about an artist and what an artist knows about their fans, and like really quantify what it means to be a fan of somebody and what's good and bad in that relationship. That's all. I could elaborate for 3 hours, but this is not the time, or it is the place, but it's not the time.
Josh, you have any thoughts?
Not on that. Nope.
Great.
Sure don't.
Okay. I'd like to hear your cap.
Okay, guys. Yeah. Now, you're both probably going to be embarrassed for me, but don't worry about it.
No, that's actually, Josh, I want to say something. So in a similar vein as Caleb, when he was on your podcast, I would like to know if you are okay right now or if you're sad.
Oh my gosh, because this is becoming a theme.
No, yeah, it is, because I'm happy and I have very much enjoyed this, but I would like you to not be sad.
No, I honestly am not sad at all.
Okay, great.
Right now, I was just doing a lot of listening on this particular show.
Yeah, but you wanted to be the one interacting a lot, which makes me sad, maybe. Maybe I'm the one who's sad.
Hmm. Yeah, it's hard when you and Andy are in person and I
feel bad.
Far away. So far away from you.
Well, can I ask a question then?
Bear Streets song.
Can I ask a question then? If Caleb gets to come back, can I come back and can I hear, can you and me talk more than me and Andy?
Yeah. Yeah, of course.
Okay, great. Okay, now cap it out.
Okay. So anyway, guys, Andy, don't cut me off with the end music before I'm done.
I'll let you determine when that happens.
Thank you. And and you guys can laugh and you can even join in, but please don't interrupt me.
Can we cry?
You might.
Okay. I'm bracing myself. I don't know what's happening.
Meow, meow, meow. Meow, meow, meow. Meow, 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 meow.
I'm picturing the helicopter right now.
Do I have your permission?